Hi, I'm Paul Stewart, and I'm going to give you a quick introduction to IoT in agriculture. Just a little bit about myself. I'm a mechatronic engineer with Department of Agriculture and Fisheries, and I'm based in Toowoomba. So what's the Internet of Things? You might have heard that in the media. It's connecting internet-enabled devices that relay information, and that might be information back to us, to cloud-based applications, or to each other, so from device to device. And if you combine that with automated systems, it's possible to gather information, analyze it, and maybe even create an action if you need to. So digital agriculture, including the collection and analysis of farm data, could increase the gross value of Australian agriculture production by about $20 billion. And IoT solutions could actually deliver annual benefits of $14 to $22 billion to the sector. They've worked out that that could come from improved crop and livestock yields, reduced wastage and livestock mortality, and operational process improvements on the farm, and maintenance and labour cost savings, and that's a big one. So some of the current issues that are facing IoT in agriculture. Many IoT systems out there, especially used when in industrial applications, are reliant on internet access through a hard wire or Wi-Fi. Telecommunications and internet in rural Australia face issues outside towns and major centres. That's probably no surprise to anybody listening to this. And where there is mobile coverage, ongoing SIM cards costs can be prohibitive depending on the plan you're on. And there's also a high cost of setting up your own networks and nodes and sensors, especially for off-the-shelf and proprietary products. So one of the things that I've been investigating over the last few years is LoRa networks, or long range networks, that's what that stands for. They can go up to 15 to 20 Ks, making it suitable for extensive agricultural systems. They've got very low power usage. So a sensor can operate on a battery for even a couple of years. Just to give you an idea about how much power that is, they use anywhere from about 25 milliwatts up to 1 watt, versus if you're talking about your UHF radio systems that are out there, they're using 5 watts as a base. From end to end, their communications are encrypted. So it's both secure on the transmission and in the network back end. And we've got a fairly low cost of deployment for end nodes and gateways. At the moment, it's all open source. That means anybody can develop it, which means the competition out there is for keep the prices down is pretty good. So just to give you an idea, that can be as low as $20 for like an individual node if you're building it yourself from bits, and $300 for a gateway, and multiple farms can share that. But typically costs are a little bit higher than that. So just to give you an idea about where LoRa fits with all the other type of telecommunications technology, we've got things like Wi-Fi, which has huge bandwidth capacity, but the range and the distance of it is fairly limited. You live a few hundred meters. Bluetooth, we've got a little bit less capacity in there and certainly lower. And RFID, like cattle ear tags and things like that, you're only talking a few meters. And then we've got our traditional 2G and 3G and 4G and even 5G networks that are coming. Certainly lots of bandwidth capacity and a long range distance. And LoRa kind of sits down here in this area. So it's got fairly low bandwidth, so we're only talking small amounts of information at any one time, but it does have long range. And the current world LoRaWAN record is 832 kilometers. They did that with a balloon, but only using 25 milliwatts of power. The furthest that I've got so far is 85 kilometers. So just to give you a bit of an idea about how the network is set up. So we have our sensor nodes, and they may be things out in the paddock. I'll go through some examples in a minute. And so they transmit information through to a gateway. And the gateway may sit on the farm, or it may be on your neighbour's place. And they're connected to the internet, which then talks to one that I use. It's called the Things Network. And it's the server where all the information gets sent. And from there, you can send it out to lots of different places. So you can send it out to your dashboards. You can make things happen through automation. and you can share information with a lot of other applications. And right from end to end, we have a secure payload right from where the node starts, right through this system. So just a bit about LoRaWAN security. Obviously, when we're collecting lots of data, security is one major component of that that people should be aware of. So both the payload, which is the information that's actually sent, and the wrapper that kind of it sits in, is all encrypted using 128-bit keys. So that's to give you an idea. This is what one of the keys looks like. So you have to get that exact combination and a combination of those. There's three that you actually use to be able to crack that. And that is one of the industry standards of the moment. There's LoRaWAN protocol actually offers two layers of security. So the network that it sits on. So the network session key has to validate that the node is actually supposed to be joining that network. And then also that if you send a sequence of messages, that if somebody tries to inject a message into there to maybe spoof a message coming through, if that number doesn't match between the previous one and the next one, it gets rejected as well. And then we've also got some more security on top of that, that the payload is actually encrypted and decrypted at either end, and you need keys and passwords and things to be able to do that as well. So it basically means that even though we're sending across public networks, that nobody except you is able to intercept and understand those messages. So a bit of an idea on cost, and I suppose this is a bit of a do-it-yourself cost, but prices are certainly coming down for things on the market at the moment where it's off the shelf, ready to go. And so you're talking about the gateway for a start, and anywhere from about $300 up to fairly expensive industrial type ones for about $3,000. But you can really put together some cheap stuff just from China, and you can see a couple of the little boards that we can use. But mind you, this takes soldering and wires and all that kind of stuff. Most people wouldn't want to muck around with that stuff. But I mean, we can put together a little node that sends information for us for about $25. So, I mean, at the minimum, if you put a gateway and a few sensors together, you're looking at about $425. That you could set up a really basic network for. And certainly people, when they're starting out and playing, like students and unis and things, can do it for that. So just some current uses that we see across other industries. We've got industrial and home automation and monitoring. So there's examples of water leak detection, power monitoring, security. So we can do motion and window and door sensors, smoke and carbon monoxide alarms, and temperature, humidity and damp sensors. We've got smart utilities, so smart lights, water meters, things like that. There's a lot of councils that are implementing water meters with LoRaWAN at the moment. And then there's smart logistics, so there's trucking companies that are starting to put these kind of things in there. That supplements the other networks that I'll talk about later as well. And then we've got things like environmental management and monitoring. We see quite a few of these around the world where there's like flooding networks, so you've got advanced warnings of floods coming down, or things that we've got in the Great Barrier Reef, because these the long range really assists, because we can talk to a base station that's quite a fair way away. So in applications, there's huge amounts of sensors out there. It's just a matter of being able to make them talk to your node, and then LoRa is just one of the transmission ways of how that we can get that information back to the internet. So how can agriculture benefit? This is just a few of the ways that I've seen implemented already, and I'm starting to experiment with a lot of these too. But I think before you kind of start to think about what's out there, you've got to really focus on what the end use case is and maybe what's the most appropriate thing, because LoRa may not be the best way to do it every time. So we've seen, I've set up lots of weather stations so we can determine trends and climatic conditions at a micro level on your farm, not just at the bomb sites. We can do irrigation scheduling, so we can use soil moisture sensors. We can have local environmental data going into that. You can even start and stop pumps, because we can turn them on and off. It's LoRaWAN, it's a two-way communication. And we can make, improve spraying decisions, like improve your record keeping of the conditions. We can provide local and accurate data for on your farm. You could even have several on your farm if you've got topography that is different with wind direction and stuff. And then we've got it, we can work out things like delta T just with our weather station and keep that up to date. And you can even keep that in the cab of your tractor as you're spraying. We've seen things from like remote operations, so opening gates for grazing management. We can get tank and trough levels so you don't have to go and do a run around the property and do that. And even set up some pig traps with some trap indicators so that if the pig trap, the gate has dropped or not. One of the common uses that is easy to set up is movement sensors and vehicle movement sensors as well, and diesel tank monitors and alarms. So if you've got a problem with theft, or even just to know where things are, we can whack a GPS on one of these little nodes and it can tell the location anywhere within you got your reception. When you start to get a network of LoRaWAN gateways, this gets better and better. And we can do livestock and crop monitoring. So we can put, I've seen little ear tags on cattle. You can put collars on cattle as well. And so we can work out grazing patterns. We can look at soil moisture and temperature and soil nutrients at depth, even though that's a bit beyond the average kind of cropping system at the moment because they're really expensive. So we can grab all that data and send it to dashboards, and then we can also include alerts and alarms and do some kind of thing if something's out of spec, or say in that farm security, if we see a tractor moving that shouldn't be moving. Now we can start to send ourselves like an email or an SMS straight away. Or things like when we set up weather stations, we can send it to even community websites like Weather Underground. You can see one there. Or you can build your own dashboards. It's not too difficult. And so we've got here, like you can see that it collects lots of information. We've got temperature, including the history of the data, and humidity. We've got wind speed, wind direction, and then battery level of the node just to make sure things are charging. And we can even pull in other information. Where I live at Highfields, just north of Toowoomba, I can bring in the bomb forecast as well and put all that on the one place. So that, like I said before, when we're thinking about the appropriate technology, LoRaWAN is good for small amounts of information. And there's certainly some providers out there, and you probably would have heard about Goanna Ag. Tom Dowling set up that from Gundawindi. They're providing networks and sensors, including weather stations and soil moisture sensors, and working out delta T and things like that. So there's a great local service that you can see there. Mesh is another company in Australia that's setting up LoRaWAN networks, and Triple N Co as well. They've got a big rollout in New South Wales, and they're spreading out across Australia. So some of the alternatives to LoRaWAN, Sigfox is a very similar type of technology. They use a model where Sigfox, or Thinkstra is the company that operates in Australia, will actually set up the networks for you and then charge you a per message type of arrangement. And Goanna Ag and Triple N Co kind of work on that same thing. So you don't have to set up the network. You don't have the costs of maintaining it and something goes wrong. So that's the service that you're paying for there. Certainly coming up quickly now and expanding rapidly is narrowband IoT. And that's provided by a lot of the big telcos. Certainly Telstra and Optus are two of the bigger ones when they're doing that kind of stuff. And then we're starting to see a lot of SIM card plans that are becoming very affordable and devices out there that are starting to use these networks. There's other ones like Cat M1, it's a bit more higher power usage, so things like logistics companies and things are going to be using those. And then there's ones that have been established on the market for quite a while, like Taggle. They've been doing cattle as well as water meters for councils and things for quite a while. And then there's other things like Zigbee, Wi-Fi, obviously you've probably heard about because you use that around your house and on your phones and things. And then 3G and 4G, and what's coming is 5G. So that's a few of the alternatives out there. They've all got their pros and cons as to the distance, the bandwidth, and the cost. But LoRaWAN certainly has its place, and I think we'll see it develop, as well as I think satellite technology is also going to improve, and the costs are going to come down on that. So it won't be too long before we might be moving to just satellite technology. So just thanks. That was just a quick intro for you. I sit in Toowoomba. You can get me on that email address if you would like to send me an email and any questions. But happy to answer any questions and just point people in the right direction. Thank you.